All right. One more time. How y'all doing? Great and yee-haw. Somebody's been relocated. That's all I can say about that. But we're glad you're here. I want to welcome our friends. Join us online as well. Great to have you guys with us. So let me ask a couple questions. First of all, for many of you, this is the first time I have had an opportunity to just say Happy New Year. So Happy New Year. Anybody here tired? Raise your hand if you're tired. Maybe you're not. Maybe you're not tired. You didn't raise your hand because you woke up today just totally rested and refreshed, and you thought about getting yourself a cup of coffee, some caffeine, but you thought, you know what, I can't do that. That would be like throwing kerosene on a fire because I'm so alive today. Maybe you took a look in the mirror and you stood in front of it after you got up and rolled out of bed this morning. You thought, you know, man, as I look in the mirror here this morning, I am so full of health and vitality and life, I scare myself. I mean, that's sort of how you woke up today. And maybe not. Maybe those were your first thoughts and maybe they weren't. I'm convinced that if the evil one, the enemy who opposes anything good in our lives, can't get us to deliberately, openly, defiantly, you throw your own words in front of that, disobey God, choose not to follow him, then he'll do everything he can to make us busy. Everything he can to overload our lives, everything he can to overwhelm us and make us feel unfocused and exhausted. And because either way, how many of you know the truth is, we miss out on God's best. Whether it's open defiance or just an overcrowded, overloaded life, we still miss out on God's best. Either way, we fail to become all that God created us to be and experience all that he created us for. I have some good news for you today. How many like good news? Here's the good news. Soul fatigue is not God's will for the human race. Jesus came to offer us and teach us about another way of doing this thing called life. And so our series theme verses are found in Matthew's account of the gospel. That's the good news that is recorded because of Jesus' life. And we find in the Message paraphrase, I love the way it reads, follow along. Are you tired? How many of you raise your hand? Or you didn't raise your hand, but you are tired. He would be asking you this. Are you worn out? Maybe you're not tired or worn out. How about the third question? Are you burned out on religion? Jesus said, if that's where you're at, come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Now, here's what I like. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. And learn the unforced rhythms of grace. Jesus is offering us an invitation, and with it, an amazing promise. An amazing promise. This is not just an invitation to come to Christ initially for salvation. It is that. That's certainly the invitation that he extends to every person on the planet. But it's so much more than that. It's not just to come to know him in salvation, but it's to come to know him in life. My point is, Jesus has invited us to come and experience life his way. Think about it. It's an ongoing open invitation to a better way of life, a life that truly satisfies. Thus, the New Year series, Margin, creating space for a life that truly satisfies. I shared this with our team when we huddled earlier before the service began today, and I just said, you know, I'm convinced that that really is probably where a majority of the population is living at. And you're saying, well, what do you mean by that? They're going through the motions, and we're surrounded here in suburbia. I call it Kidville. How many of you know there's a lot of kids around here? Some of you have done your part contributing. Some of you are still working on it. Thank you very much. But here's where I'm going. It's not just Kidville. It's Stuffville. We have all kinds of stuff, but we're still dissatisfied. Something's still missing. And I would include within that characterization a lot of people who are believers. They know Jesus, but they don't know the life that he came to give. Oh, they have their fire insurance. They've secured their eternal destiny by putting their faith in him and him alone, but there's still something missing. They're a little bit disillusioned, quite frankly, with their faith, because they're thinking, is this all there is to it? Is this really what I signed up for? And I want to say, no, there's a whole lot more that God has for all of us. And so we're going to spend the next several weeks learning how to do what Jesus invites us to do, where he said, come to me and you'll recover your life. You'll recover the life that I intend you to have. And so that's where we're going over the next number of weeks, a life that truly satisfies. So where do we begin? Where do we begin? Well, let me back up and say, if you're ever going to go on a trip, what do you need? What two things do you need before you embark on that journey? I'm not talking about packing your bags. And I saw somebody posted on Facebook, maybe it was yesterday, said, yeah, I'm going on a trip, and I'm only gone for a few days, so I probably only need about 3 outfits, but I have 17, so I think I'm ready. No, it's not those two things. I'm talking about what are two primary things that you need if you're going on a trip someplace you've never been before. The first thing you need is where you're going, your destination, right? And the second thing you need is to know where you're at currently, because if you don't know where you are now, you'll never get to where you want to go. So if we put that in the context of this thing called life and a life that truly satisfies and recovering our life, where are we headed? Where are we going in this series? Where do we want to go in life? I would just say it this way. We're headed to the land of life the way God intended it to be. A life that is, are you ready for this? I'm going to characterize some things, and you dream with me for a minute and tell me if this isn't the kind of life that you really ultimately want to sign up for. A life that's, first of all, relationally rich, where your relationships are not strained. There's not tension in the home or in the classroom or on the athletic field or at the workplace, wherever you are, but you're relationally rich. Second, you're financially free. How many of you would just say right there, that sounds good to me. Financially free. You're not strapped. You have margin. I'll get back to that. You're spiritually satisfied. You could say, it is well with my soul. You're fully alive. And you're emotionally energized. What do I mean? In other words, we are fully alive. We do wake up in the morning rested and refreshed. We don't need that caffeine fix or that coffee to jumpstart our day. Come on, somebody. The life of God has infused us. I'm stepping on some stuff right now. In fact, we roll out of bed in the morning, and when our feet hit the floor each morning, the devil says, oh, crap, he or she is up again. Your family and friends are always glad to see you. Your neighbors don't want you to move away because you add so much value to the hood. Your boss or employees think you're the best and they'd hire you again or give you a raise just because you're you. You're just that good. You have money in the bank, so when God says give, you can give, and when God says go, you can go because you have this thing called margin. Now, how many of you would say, I'm ready to sign up for that kind of life? That's the kind of life that Jesus came to give us. Relationally rich, financially free, spiritually satisfying, and emotionally energized. That's the life that Jesus came to give us. That's where we're going. That's where we're headed. So where are we now? Where are we now? I put together a checklist that I'd like to just look at. And as we look at 5 indicators, your job today is simply to determine where you're at with each one. And you'll find that within your worship guide. So there are message notes right there on the page. You can also follow along on YouVersion, by the way, but you won't be able to actively fill in some blanks here, but you can mentally use that checklist if you choose to. But on each one, it's just to determine yes or no. I'm there, I'm not there. And you'll find that list. So let's dive in. Get a pen and follow along. That is unless you're too tired today. All right, you ready? Number 1, a frequent or constant sense of feeling rushed. In other words, you consistently feel like there are just not enough hours in the day. You have too many things to do, too many obligations to be carried out, and you know, there just isn't enough time, and there's almost this epidemic in our society today, and we're obsessed with going even faster. Years ago, I read a book by a guy by the name of Richard Swenson, where I got the idea for the series for this, title for this series, called Margin. And here's what he said, quote, in other words, he's saying we're addicted to this thing of going faster. He said, quote, just take a look at our lives. We send packages by Federal Express, use a long-distance company called Sprint, manage our personal finances on Quicken, diet with Slim Fast, and swim in trunks made by Speedo. How many could do with all that except the swimming trunks? Why is it? Because there's no margin in our lives. One thing goes wrong, there's one interruption, one delay, and we can't seem to catch up. Our schedule's off for the rest of the day. We live with this constant sense of feeling rushed or fatigued. I'd like to say more about it, but we don't have time this morning, so let's go on to the next one. Number two, on your notes. And by the way, just go ahead and indicate now. Would you say, yeah, I live there with a frequent or constant sense of feeling rushed? Or no, I'm good. Number two, difficulty making decisions. We're so obsessed with wanting lots of alternatives that we're living in what experts call choice overload. Choice overload. How many of you have ever walked into a restaurant and been handed, not a menu, a book? It's called Cheesecake Factory. In fact, I'm hungry, but we're supposed to be fasting starting today, so, you know, it'll be a while till I get there. But how many ever look at that book and just trying to make a decision on what you're going to eat is like, holy cow, I don't know. Too many choices. Choice overload. How many of you have ever wrestled with indecision? Raise your hand. How many of you aren't sure? Gotcha. All right, check the box. Check the box. Yes or no? Number three, a surplus of information, but a deficit of wisdom. We're the most informed people that have ever lived in the history of the world. We have this incredible thing called the information highway. We can go online, we can Google anything we want, get any information. And I find myself, I do it all the time. I'll be in a conversation with somebody, and I'll reference something. I'll say, you know what? I can look that up right now, and I'll do it, or they'll do it. We have access to more information than any people in the history of the world. Knowledge is on overload, but are we the wisest, I would ask? Will people look back at this generation at some point in the future history and say, those people were so filled with this beautiful thing called wisdom, they lived a quality of life like nobody else. They were fully satisfied. They were relationally rich. They were financially free. They lived out this thing called wisdom. I think we've confused information with wisdom. 2 Timothy 3:7 says, we're always learning and never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. Information and knowledge and wisdom are not the same thing. How many of you would agree with that? Knowledge implies that we what? We know something. But wisdom is the application of knowledge. Wisdom is knowing what to do with what we know. And here's the power of deception. If you knew or you deceived, you wouldn't be deceived. And so the deception is we think that because we know something here, that we know it in reality. But in reality, we don't know it until it's changed the way we live our life. And so, wisdom is about knowing how to live and doing it. Where would you be at on that one? Would you say, I'm a little bit here deficient on wisdom, but man, I know a lot. Number four, a sense of stagnation or superficiality in my relationship with God. How would you rate yourself on this one? Do you have a sense that things are stagnant in your spiritual life? You're saying, well, yeah, Keith, that's why I'm here. I'm starting a new year, you know, in pursuit of more. Awesome. Because you can't get to where you're going until you know where you are. It may look like this. When God's people get together for a weekend worship experience like this, or in a life group was what we call them here at 3D through the week, sometimes you're there, sometimes you're not. It's sort of, you know, if it's convenient, I'll find my way. It's on again, off again. It all depends on my schedule, my mood, what the weather's like. Are the mountains calling today? On the other hand, you might say, my prayers are often hurried. I pray on the go, and we should and can because we have access 24/7. That's the liberation of the relationship we have with God and our access to Him. But I'm talking about some concentrated time sitting in His presence where you're actually allowing Him to speak into your life about every decision you make, and you're accessing the wisdom from His Word and engaging with it in a very personal and saturated sense. Or would you say, you know what, Keith, I'm really not deliberately having my thoughts and emotions shaped by God's Word. I'm not seeing my life change and my character develop the way that it should. I'm not really growing spiritually. I'm just sort of on an even plane. Giving. Are you eager and excited when there's opportunity to express your love to God in giving? Or is your heart cooled to the point where sometimes you give, sometimes you don't? It's just if it's convenient, if it fits the budget, you know, that's an indicator of spiritual life and vitality and heart. Because the Bible says wherever your treasure is, that's where your heart is. Does God have your heart? Or are you a little stagnant or superficial spiritually? Let's get honest. Yes or no? Where are you at in your journey? And then finally, a decreased ability to love and connect with others. I'm pretty confident if we took a vote on this one, nobody would sit here this morning and say, you know what, Keith, I'm working this year. My New Year's resolution is to become a less loving person. No takers on that. Why? Nobody sets out at the beginning of a new year and says, I'm going to become a less loving person. No, most of us are saying, I want to become more loving. So the issue isn't about desire. It's about capacity. We just don't know how because of the culture we're in, or we just don't have the capacity because we're living on empty. We're running on empty and living in overload. So there's no margin, which I believe is where the best relationships in life are experienced. In addition to leading and pastoring this amazing church, you, I do leadership and executive coaching with an organization called Character Quest. And in the context of that, there's a lot of opportunities that present themselves. And one of the three primary points of focus for what we do is really to have an impact on this incredible group of amazing young people called millennials that I think are phenomenal. A lot of them get a bad rap. It's a group of people that were born probably sometime between 1984 and then fast forward 18 years. That's what makes up a generation. And a couple of weeks ago, I came across a video asking this guy, Simon Sinek, what he calls the millennial question. I'm going to share that video with you now. Some of you have maybe already seen it and accessed it, but it is so impacting that I want to show it its entirety, which is unusual for us to do something like that. But I think it nails like where we're at culturally. And so without any more, watch this, and then I'll come and wrap up the message and move into our worship and response time. Pretty impacting, right? I have a number of observations. I only have time to share two. First of all, can I just say this is not a millennial issue. This is a cultural issue. It's the introduction of technology in our society that's not just impacted the generation that it was first introduced to early on that had been trained by it, but it's leaked upstream to the point where I don't care what your age is, you're impacted by it. I was deeply impacted and, can I say, convicted in some areas as I watched that a few weeks ago. Second, Simon says we have a cultural issue that we need to deal with. And he says it's the company's responsibility to take the lead on that, because society has failed this emerging generation called millennials. As a coach engaged in that environment, in the corporate context, I would agree to an extent. As a church leader, I'd suggest that it's ultimately the burden rests on the shoulders of the church to step into this space and address the ill and illness in our culture. That's why I gave you a 17-minute video this weekend. In fact, I think it's why the church exists. It's why Jesus came, that we might have life and have it in abundance to the full until it overflows. And who is to propagate and communicate that message are those who have been on the receiving end of that life, who are now in turn to share that life. So it is our responsibility. In fact, that's why the church exists. That's why we exist. It's we say it around here all the time. God made you on purpose and for a purpose. And one of the introductory thoughts is that people looking to make a difference in the corporate context are saying, I just want a purpose. I want to know that my life has impact. Rick Warren said it this way in his classic book, The Purpose-Driven Life. You are made by God and for God, and until you understand that, life will never make sense. Here at 3D, we're passionately committed to helping you discover what your purpose is. So passionate, we've designed some classes for that very reason. We call it Next Steps, because where do I go from here in my journey? Just a real short video, about 90 seconds, to just give an introduction to that, to all of you, and especially those maybe that are new with us.
My name is Olivia Goolsby. I am 23, and I just finished my Next Steps class and design session.
Hi, my name is Mike. This is my beautiful wife, Veronica, and we just went through Next Steps.
And it was amazing. I loved it. It was so much fun. We had such a great connection, a great bond together. We met a lot of great people, and I absolutely enjoyed it.
Hi, my name is Gustavo Rojas, and this is my lovely wife, Jackie Rojas.
My experience was amazing. I was really hesitant at first because I'm so introverted and I had to go by myself, but it was amazing, and I think it's something that everybody needs to go through.
What I love most about Next Steps is that it's the environment is nice and friendly, open.
Keith does just such a great job in really connecting with everybody and really showing us what God's purpose is for us, and it was just transforming. It was awesome.
One of the things I took away was tithing. Once we started implementing with us, doing it, it opened a lot of doors for us.
I have a completely different outlook on the church and the mission and God's mission for the church and what it's supposed to do for the world.
So if that is something to be of interest to you, just invite you to use your connection card indicating your interest. You can go online and sign up, or you can text, and there's instruction in your worship guide to do that as well. It'll get you signed up. Let me just wrap it up, because we want to move into a time of worship and reflection and response. I don't know about you, I love this time of year for a lot of reasons. One of the primary reasons is a new year to me just symbolizes this concept of new. Like new beginnings, fresh start, clean slate. I love that. I really do. I think there's something in the human psyche and soul that says, if we could just start over. And that's what a new year in many ways represents and symbolizes. I've also experienced enough new years to know that turning the page of a calendar doesn't equal or guarantee the change or changes that we all long for. If it did, then the statistics would turn out different, because I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but out of all those that set goals in a new year and make New Year's resolutions and resolve to change something, when it's all said and done 12 months later, only 8% of the population is successful in their endeavors. So maybe there's a better way to approach it. I believe there is, and that's what I'd like to offer up as we wrap it up today. Because the truth is, why do we make resolutions set goals, and resolve to change something in the first place. Because there's something missing. There's something we're looking for, that we're searching for, that we're reaching for, that's not yet a part of our current experience, because if it was, there'd be no need to live in pursuit of it. You don't pursue something you already have. And yet, oftentimes, most of us set the same goals and make the same resolutions year after year after year. And I'm just saying, let's resolve to do it differently. What's missing, I believe, is that life that truly satisfies. And you might be wondering, Keith, is that even possible? And I want to just say, absolutely. It's the very reason Jesus came. John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus said this, I have come that they might have and enjoy life, have it to the full in abundance until it overflows. How many would say, I want to sign up for that? I want to have and enjoy life, have it in abundance to the full until it's just overflowing. That's what I would love to have. And some of you are saying, well, Keith, that really doesn't define my life. How many of you would say that does define your life? You don't have to raise your hand, but if that's you, I would just say congratulations. You're in the minority. Even as a Christian, most of us would say, that's not really my story. And so, if not, how do we get there? Well, let's go back to our series theme verse. Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Jesus said, come to me, get away with me, and you will recover your life. You'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. How many of you could hear in Simon's communication reference to something that we could categorically say fit into this thing we call rhythms of grace? When they're absent, we give the message that life is great, but we're depressed. We're not being real. And yet we sort of almost boast about being the generation that's real. And we're more plastic than any previous generation. So God's intent is to restore our souls. And that was voiced a long time ago, and I don't have time to get into it. From David the psalmist, and maybe we'll capture it next week or in the weeks to come. But here's what I want to communicate right now. There are two choices that we can make today that will get us started, and that's why I titled this message, Getting Started. I'm not saying today you're going to get the magic pill and it's going to be a cure-all and you got the fix and now you're good to go. We're just going to get started today. How do we get started recovering our life? Choose to surrender my life to Jesus. If you've never done that, in a moment I'm going to give you an opportunity to honestly, genuinely surrender your life to the author of life, the one who made you on purpose and for a purpose so you can receive that life. That's the first one. Jesus said in John 10, 14, 17, I am the good shepherd. My sheep know me, they listen to my voice, and they follow me. Those three words is what it means to have Jesus as your guide, your shepherd. You know Jesus, you listen to Jesus, you follow Jesus. For that to happen, we have to, number two, and here it is, choose to create space for him to fill. We can't, how many of you... have some people that you're really connected to relationally, you love them or you're just getting to know them, but how many of you know you don't get to know them better if you don't spend time with them? How are we going to get to know Jesus if we don't spend time with Jesus? How are we going to hear his voice if we don't create some space to listen? And if we don't know him and know his voice, then we aren't following him even if we think we are. So the whole idea of creating space for him to fill is the big idea around why we do 21 days of prayer and fasting. When we start something new and exciting, and want something new and exciting to happen, how many of you know we have to create space for that? And one of the best metaphorical pictures I can give you is having a baby. Now, don't raise your hand if you're expecting and haven't told your family. But if you're having a baby this year, you already know that. You're already thinking about that room that you're going to prepare. And as you prepare that room, think about this. you get excited because you're thinking, and you maybe already have a gender reveal thing that's going on, or you're still not sure, you're choosing not to because there aren't many unknowns left in life, so you're saying we're going to wait until the day of their birth. Either way, you're preparing a room for a boy or a girl or both because you're going to have twins. And as you prepare that room, how do you know the sense of excitement, anticipation builds? But listen to what I'm going to say. Your excitement isn't built around the space. Your excitement is all about what's going to fill that space. That's fasting to me. Fasting, and we're going to give you an opportunity to identify, what are you going to fast from and what are you going to fast for? But my primary focus isn't what I'm fasting from, because it's not the space that gets me excited. It's what I'm fasting for, because I can't wait to see what God's going to put in that space that I create for him to fill, which is going to be himself and his love and his truth and his grace and his wisdom and his word and his life. The very thing that the soul of our society is crying out for. Millennials, boomers, busters, or Gen Z, or even a few builders we have in the house. That's the cry of the human heart, is life. And we have to create space in order for that life to be poured in order for it to be lived out and realized. That's why we fast and pray. See, we don't fast. Listen, I got to say this, and then I got to move on because of time. We don't fast and just not eat. If all you do is fast, I said this on a video I did yesterday afternoon. I want to say it here because I think it's really relevant. If all you do is not eat and keep working or keep studying or keep busy around the house and just skip the meal, two things happen. Number one, you get hungry, and number two, you get really cranky. The purpose of fasting is to fill it with something else. So what if every time you're fasting, maybe you're just fasting one meal a day, every day, for the next 21 days, and you take a half-hour lunch break or an hour break or whatever it is, or you do it in the evening after you're home from work, what if you filled that space with life from God, prayer, time in His Word, study, meditation, and let Him fill it up? So now, get this, we fast to feast. I want to encourage a whole lot of us, including Keith, to not just consider what we're going to fast physically in the realm of food, but what are we going to fast in the world of technology? What about all the amazing points that Simon made of the emotional, psychological, relational, spiritual, he didn't say, impacts of this thing called technology and what it's done to bankrupt the soul of our nation and the world, and yet we think we're more connected than ever? What if we just applied some of those things? When we go out with our family or friends to dinner, only one person takes their cell phone, and only for the purpose of an emergency. What if we're in business meetings or social settings and our phone isn't accessible? And here's the key. What if we filled that space with prayer?